Namdar Zeme Gange Lunjindo, Tense Nime Nyanla Kuchan Jengengu Kunji Rije Sondo Je Rangyong Choko Khaji Lopen Zo Pekam Chongwe Nyenji Gatin Je Ujian Sanji Nyebar Sowa Chakun Sangwan Zimbe Wangchuk Gantun Bin Jansan Tumtun Shinyin Zo Silden Tome Chune Gatin Je Kinjian Pote Sotar Sowa De Je Kun Chara Je Shin Jambe Yang Shindir Samshin Cho Chun Kanchen Tenbe Shinda Gatin Je Ngada Chason Tuzan La Sowa De Shavu La So Tergo Mhantu Je Kanchen Tendru De Je Nyima Shar Taye Du Je Gatin Cho Je Cho Jal Terda Lingbar Sowa De Rekun Chabda Pemin Jasab Che Vasan Do Je Nyingbo Kongso De Najor Huanju Hiro Kapil Cho Trichen Kunsa Wanchil Tuna Je Yente Lepi Yenten Tamche Chowe Tusum Jawa Seche Chepe Ya Sanche Kunle Lhape Gatin Che Palden Lame Shabla Sowa De Jawa Kundu Kawan Kholwe La Gatin Sumten Tzawe Lama Da Irme Rangri Rangu Ronyan Pe Nelu Chishin Tokpar Sowa Rangri Dune Yongda Ninzin Chi Chinwa Kata Longdu Shabar Chi Sochir Minne Kunsan Dume Kun Tzede Nila Ngundu Jobar Kata Rangri Junu Bungke Dan Zime Lundro Nambar Jamle Pe Minjurin De Chien Samen Du De Yongzo Rikzen Lamar Sowa De Ngagi Wangjo Chente Nupe Zan Namjo Turmin Sheji Chukun La Wangjo Lo Sao Do La Kunge Zolze Tinchen Lamar Sowa De Sanji Nipa Pema Junne Chi Renglu Nyurwa Mepi Shetru Jin Jansui Kone Chuchir Giwe Shi Jelze Pao Chol Sowa De Chanchu Simjo Rinpoche Maje Banam Jejur Ji Jeba Nyamba Mepa Da Kone Kondo Pevar Shou Chanchu Simjo Rinpoche Maje Banam Jeba Nyamba Mepa Da Kone Kondo Pevar Shou Chanchu Simjo Rinpoche Maje Banam Jejur Ji Jeba Nyamba Mepa Kone Kondo Pevar Shou. So, good morning. How are you all? I was just teasing Greg about getting us all up here on a Monday morning. So normally, all the cities, Buddhists always seem to be more busy during the Friday evenings, the Saturdays, and the Sundays. And it's uncommon to sort of assemble everyone on a Monday morning, but San Francisco has always been unique in many ways. So we've been doing the Nagarjuna's letter, excerpts from the Nagarjuna's letter to his spiritual friend. And within that, the preliminaries and the conclusions, concluding summarization of the text, of which the main part, and within the main part, the sort of main topics that are contained within the bulk of the commentary and the root verses is based upon the six paramitas. And so different approaches to the paramitas, of course, are there. It is the very ground basis of the Mahayana teachings. But a uniqueness of the Nagarjuna's letter is within the topic of the six paramitas, how very beautifully he has combined. Also, what essentially is always seen as either a Madhyamika topic or even Vajrayana topic. And so, four reminders which are very much explained as a very important topic, most oftentimes has always been regarded as the preliminaries. outer preliminaries of Vajrayana practices. In that regard, again, all teachings can approach, however, and all of them are very, very valuable, very, very precious, and it would be incorrect to sort of select a particular topic as being more crucial, more important than the others. One couldn't do it, and also it is not advisable to do that. Everything is very precious. That's it being one. Then second is, no matter which topic you take within that particular topic, all other topics are actually ingrained. It's just another variation of approaching all the other topics. That must be also understood by meditators. However, in this context, however, we can say that some of the most, if we are able to select, some of the most essential topics, particularly three topics, are in Buddha Dharma, the very fundamental core essence of all the teachings. And without the understanding of these three different sets of teachings, most probably a person will not be able to gain a full understanding and insight of Buddha Dharma. Of these three, then I would say the most crucial is Four Noble Truths. Many times today, I think on the first day, I said there is this absolute inspiring inspiration as well as sort of great encouragement that we find in the diligence and exertion of practices in the Western students. And so that's very true. Nevertheless, West or Eastern students, both seemingly in this world, despite all the hearings of the Dharma and the teachings and practices, encounter tremendous struggle with Buddha Dharma itself, to specially bring together a view, meditation, and action, the three aspects. So we have a certain view. When you listen to teachings, you get a view and an understanding of the view. In the beginning, that view is very conceptual and deliberate in that one agrees with it, but the agreeing with it is not based upon one's own research and examination, and therefore lacks in certainty. Now, however, when the process of working with the view and finding devotion, faith, and conviction in the view is being done, it is assisted by meditation. And so I think much of our life as modern day practitioners are spent in meditating a lot so as to gain some understanding and at least a trust in the view, some kind of faith in the view. So the exertion that we admire so much is in this aspect of meditation. However, the fault that we often seem to get into is the inability to bridge the gap between view and action. And so we almost work so hard with the meditation to gain certainty of the view, but when it comes to applying it in action, there still seems to be a gap. Why it is there? It is for each individual to find out why that reluctancy is there. When we talk about view, meditation, action, fruition doesn't seem to happen as rapidly as it should. You know, we hear of times when Shakyamuni Buddha or any of the great teachers taught a teaching, and at the end of the talk or a teaching, all attained arahatship, all became bodhisattvas. Immediately they realized the mind of the guru. And we begin to think, what happened in our case? It's a sort of, you know, we do this. It's not that we lack in conviction or devotion. I'm sure it's pretty much the same thing. But on the other hand, there is something that is still missing. And when we look carefully, it seems that the fruition doesn't happen because action is a little bit different from the view we hold. So the best way is to look into one's own self and say, what kind of a view do I hold as my spiritual value? And how much of that do I actually implement in my actions? In every teaching, there is one point which says, until and unless the view and the action have no dissimilarity at all, there is no fruition. Or in other words, fruition is nothing other than a non-separation of the action and the view. And so when your action becomes nothing but the view, or the view manifests as nothing but the action, whichever way you may put it, that until it arises, Buddha Dharma hasn't manifested in that person or meditator. One has not obtained the fruition. And in this case, the second aspect, meditation, familiarity, is what is then said to be the foundation upon which the closeness and then eventually the union of the view and the action must take place. So when we say, I am meditating, in simple common language, what we are saying is, I am giving myself time to become familiar with the view to such a degree that it no longer is separate from every aspect of my action. That is what is meditation. When such a union of the view and the action arises, then one can say, I have obtained fruition of the Dharma. And so, in that way, when we are able to practice, that then is, I think, the genuine approach that must be cultivated. Now, why such doesn't happen? Where is the weakest link which does not allow us to integrate and unify the view and the action together? Today, when we look carefully, and as I was saying, despite the exertion, despite the diligence, one by one, if we look into all the possible qualities that are necessary, we will find that we do try to practice them. If someone asks you, how much devotion do you have? Most oftentimes the answer will be is fair amount. Maybe not the purest, but yes, we're all very devoted. Sense of refuge? Yes, we all take refuge. Do you trust the Dharma to be true? We all trust it to be true. Do you exert effort? Everyone exerts effort to whatever possible degree that one can. Do you value compassion? Yes, we value compassion. Do you know the selflessness of phenomena? Yes, we know the selflessness of phenomena. Do you know the selflessness of self? Yes, we know the selflessness of self. Do you agree dualistic tendencies? Yes, we agree there is dualistic tendencies. Do you agree that everything is essentially empty in nature? Yes, of course we agree, isn't it? So if you go one by one listing as to possible areas which may be the factor that doesn't lead us to really bringing the unification of the view and the action, it's very hard to actually see what is it that is the biggest possible mistake. And at the same time, three things we do say, and the Buddha has said these are the three most crucial essence of Buddha Dharma. And keeping that in mind, when we do look at whether we actually work with these three very fundamental teachings or not, and if it is weak, today many teachers have been saying that is the weakest link. Is number one, non-understanding of the Four Noble Truths. That's the biggest problem. And where the Four Noble Truths is something that we know, and all Buddhists can say, yes, Four Noble Truths, Noble Truth of Suffering, Origin, Cessation, and Path. These are the Four Noble Truths. But if you look carefully into oneself and say, do you really believe in the Noble Truth of Suffering? There's a little bit of missing factor in there, is that we do know suffering, but we don't know to such a degree that we have strong revulsion to suffering. Cause of suffering, ignorance. Yes, of course we all know ignorance. Are we willing to give up? No, we don't want to give it up to that degree that we don't have that much of a revulsion to the ignorance. We don't like it, but it's like one of those sort of bad marks on your face which you still try to beautify, isn't it? And so, in the same way, cessation, of course we would like the cessation of suffering and cessation of ignorance. That would be nice. But on the other hand, are we desperately looking for it? No. That's again quite weak. In the same way, path of practice that leads to cessation, yes, but in our own time, when we have time, when I want to, when I agree with it. So in that way, if you look carefully, the Four Noble Truths and the lack of understanding and accurate understanding of the Four Noble Truths, today, very in the modern world, or what is in the text called degenerate times, is probably one of the weakest factors that does not allow us to fully bring full fruition of the path of the practice. We meditate, but our meditation is weak in understanding of the Four Noble Truths, and therefore the union of the view and the action doesn't take place. In the same way, the second core essence of practice that again is weak in our own minds is for immeasurables: loving kindness, compassion, joyfulness, and equanimity. As Mahayana students, we love the idea of these four immeasurable good qualities of bodhicitta. But on the other hand, loving kindness is very biased and very demanding, full of expectations. Compassion is very biased, very selective. We are very selective about how and to whom we are going to be compassionate. Joyfulness is absolutely missing in most cases, anyway. Equanimity is better not to even talk about it so much, isn't it? And so these four missing factors, again, make it very difficult. Although we meditate, still, the union of the meditation as a foundation that allows the union of view and action to come about doesn't happen. It's very weak. Then another, the third very crucial subject that is again weak, which causes the inability to bring about full fruition, is the understanding of the four reminders: preciousness of human existence, impermanence, suffering of sentient beings, and karma, cause and effect. These 12 subjects, four noble truths, four immeasurables, and the four reminders, as long as these are weak, and by weak we mean if you don't really value these topics, if you haven't searched and researched them carefully, if you're not able to fully have confidence of these, confidence to such a degree that it allows your mind to really develop then only then the core quality of revulsion to samsara, revulsion to everything samsara has to offer, its habitual tendencies, its dualistic tendencies, all the fabrications and the falsities, all the kleshas, the afflictions, will never happen. That revulsion will never happen. So the strong revulsion to the afflictions and the poison of samsara doesn't arise. Strong revulsion to samsara doesn't arise. Where strong revulsion to samsara and its tendencies, causes of suffering, itself is weak in the mind of the meditator, how can such a meditator truly meditate? A meditation so unique and so very much based upon selflessness. To come about to that understanding will always be very difficult. And so all of us, therefore, need to understand the value of these three topics or the 12 instructions in one's life. Nagarjuna, in his own unique way, in this text, which is, because Nagarjuna is so much a scholar of Madhyamika and a teacher, founder of the Mahayana Madhyamika tradition, therefore his teachings are always almost connected with the Mahayana teachings, but also because of the directness of the instructions, it's a very Hinayana text too. And so in the unique semblance of the Hinayana and Mahayana teachings of this precious teaching, Spiritual Letter to a Friend by Nagarjuna, however, he does give birth to these 12 topics as being very crucial. So in summarization, if one is to say, how do I take the teachings of the letters of the Nagarjuna to heart and practice? Beyond the six paramitas, you have to find the unique way in how Nagarjuna has taken six paramitas to point out these 12 crucial points: four noble truth, four immeasurables, and the four reminders. So someone says, okay, give me a short presentation of the Nagarjuna's letter to the friend. All of you should be able to then talk about six paramitas, then within the context of the six paramitas, the four noble truth, connecting it to the four noble truth and the four immeasurable qualities, connecting it to the samadhi chapter, the fifth paramita. And then the four reminders, particularly the four reminders, connecting it to the chapter of the paramita of wisdom, the sixth paramita. And so when you are able to talk about six paramitas, six immeasurables, the four immeasurables, the four noble truth, and the four reminders, you've pretty much summarized Nagarjuna's letter to a friend. And so that's very important to keep in mind, because this also allows, in this way of summarization, it allows meditators to be free of books and texts. And you're able to simply keep the content of the teachings in your own mind and be able to sort of really take to heart the teachings and say, oh, because of having received these teachings, I should be able to give more thought to the four reminders, to the four immeasurables, and so forth. In this same way, then, as I was saying, gradually these three topics are what is primarily today's, I think, topics that we will discuss. But yesterday, in the commentary text, we talked about, in the subject of paramita of samadhi, things that one needs to abandon, which are opposing factors to concentration or perfection of meditation. And so reflecting upon those qualities, not just thinking about them or writing it, but all those negativities that causes distraction, whether it is our sense and the judgment and the opinion of the senses, liberating oneself from such distractions, liberating oneself from the clutches of the eight worldly dharmas, and liberating one's mind from all the different kinds of hope and fear that are based upon acquiring and not having acquired material wealth and different kinds of busyness that our life gets involved in, because of which inner mind, the wisdom mind, never is free from the many disturbances or the distractions. And freeing these different tendencies or harmful defects from our own mind stream, allowing then what is left to be nothing but pure concentration, pure one-pointed awareness. Now, if we look carefully from the perspective of the commentary, it says, just as you have a clear space, for example, if this table is cluttered, and removing all the clutteredness or removing all the things that are unnecessary over here, you have a clean space. In the same way, you clear your mind from distractions of eight worldly dharmas, material wealth, all the different kinds of distractions of the senses and so forth. Now, in the clarity of your own mind, free from these distractions, what should you place? What should you fill? So the second part of the paramita of samadhi talks about tuncho tsemeshi, and that is cultivating the four most important qualities that support the samadhi. And so supporting samadhi are then called the four immeasurable qualities. In the text it says, semjin thamje de deji jamba da dongal da dral deji hingje da dewa dan damba lang gawa da de da bu nyeri me par dralwe tanyum te deji tak to yang da par kombar chu chin song. Now literally here the text says, having freed the mind's one's own mind from all the distractions, fill it with the pure content of the four immeasurables. Single pointedly fill the mind with nothing but an aspiration of immeasurable happiness for all sentient beings. Generate immeasurable loving kindness for all sentient beings. Furthermore, fill one's own mind stream, the clear, uncluttered mind stream, non-distracted mind stream, with genuine sympathy or compassion for all sentient beings, wishing them to be totally free of any kind of suffering and causes of suffering. In their finding happiness and the causes of happiness, generate then and fill one's mind stream with genuine joyfulness, the third immeasurable quality. And in this way, freedom, freeing oneself from bias and partiality, allow the mind to be filled with the fourth immeasurable quality of perfect equanimity. And so these four, loving kindness, compassion, joyfulness, and equanimity, four immeasurable qualities, are what must permeate the mind of the meditator. So when you say, I am meditating, then always look carefully and see, why are you meditating? And how are you meditating? What is the benefit of your meditation? And I often joke and talk about, you know, today all kinds of meditations are there. There are people who meditate for various reasons, right from recreational meditation to, you know, some kind of beneficial spiritual meditation. Those are all very helpful in its various ways. But on the other hand, Buddhist meditation is not such meditation. Buddha Dharma meditation, as I said yesterday, is all about training your own mind. So even if you are doing, let's say, shamatha meditation, that shamatha meditation must make your mind better, kinder, more sane, more genuinely good. If you're doing vipassana meditation, analytical meditation, that also is very fine. Whether you do Mahamudra vipassana, whether you do Zen vipassana, whether you do Theravadin vipassana, it doesn't matter which vipassana you do, but that vipassana meditation must result in making, bringing about a better human being, a good human being, a genuinely kind human being. You may be doing visualization meditation of all kinds, whether it is wrathful practices or peaceful practices or whatever it is, but out of that mantra, out of that creation and completion, what must come about is a genuinely good human being. If the end result of your form or formless meditation isn't arising as the perfection of the four immeasurables, then that is again just what we call sopo in Tibetan. Sopo are, I think in English, called charlatans. It's a just appearance of meditation. And there are many, I don't know, maybe nowadays, you know, it's very easy to these situations are very easy to catch up in every country and culture. But in Tibet, there were many people who pretended to be great masters. History has it. Just as many as there are great, real, enlightened masters, there are innumerable history and anecdotes about, you know, horribly false hypocrites who are pretending to be realized or meditators simply to make an income out of it. Recently, I think many people say, oh, you shouldn't say that, you'll be shocking the Westerners and they will lose their meditation and whatever it is. And that, I think, is many years ago, but since it's catching up in the West, it's, I think, also, as we say, just on your doorstep, such fabrications. As a recently, not so recently actually, maybe 10 years ago or so, many of us at the monastery received word that a great, great treasure teacher, Therma, Tetun, a treasure revealer, was now coming into manifestation and was giving thousands of people great amount of teachings and so on and so forth. And so he was going to visit the monastery. And so it was very interesting because His Holiness Trichen Rinpoche at that time was receiving people and seeing them. And he came very full of attendance, busy attendance, and many people opening doors or whatever it is, you know how the puffed up thing we all become. So those kind of very busy things, and then brocade and long sleeves and many different layers of clothes, and also very big hair, and then I think some kind of a purpa or something in the top knot pierced over there. And then he had two suitcases full of his Dharma's treasure teachings to show to His Holiness. And then pictures, photographs of him sort of climbing up on a hill and discovering a great Therma and so forth. And then he showed him, and then we all didn't know whether it was real or not real or whatever it is. His students, I think, were more in a tizzy than the teacher himself. But then he left, and then after he left, then we asked His Holiness, what did he think about it? And he said, well, he says this is the text that he has found that was concealed by Padmasambhava. And in today's times, you can never tell true, but I really don't think, Rinpoche said, that polyester was invented in the 7th century. The text that was covered was in a polyester cloth. And so it looked old, but polyester wasn't there in Tibet at that time. So nevertheless, this person continues to still have many students and teach, and you know, students are students nevertheless, and someone you like very much, you immediately make it into a very rock star kind of a fabrication, and then another Buddhist says, my teacher is this wonderful teacher who met with the Padmasambhava and had coffee with him today, had a conversation. The other student really doesn't know what to say about it, isn't it? So says, oh, very good. And then that student goes and says, oh, Khandro Rinpoche said very good, so that must be very true. And so in that way, the situation worsens in many ways. Today, you have to be very careful. Now, why I mentioned this is just as much as you see this happening in the realm of teachers, very soon, that also happens in the realm of students. Students also begin to then more imitate the appearance of a meditator. And then, as we say, as Buddhists, we never prostrate to a shrine that has a hollow statue. Now, if you have a statue on the shrine and it hasn't been filled with the dharanis, then just a hollow statue is something that we do not venerate, because that is a very theistic. We do not venerate statues according to the words of the Buddha himself, but because it is filled with the relics and the dharanis, we do have it as a sacred object. So you should be able to keep that in mind and then have it filled if you have hollow statues. But on the other hand, what I mean over here is just as we do not venerate and prostrate to a hollow statue, likewise, if the meditator as a student or as a teacher is hollow inside, then it is not an object of veneration. Sentient beings, all of the sentient beings, whether in the human realm or elsewhere, are always made, we give them a promise. Every day we meditate, we're giving them our word and saying, I am going to be someone who will bring about the lessening of suffering in your lives. Here I am doing this solely for the reason of bringing about exhaustion of suffering and causes of suffering benefiting you. And we promise them every day. But if the person who makes the promise himself or herself is hollow, empty within, then again, who are the sentient beings going to rely upon? And on the other hand, as I said earlier, we lie all the time. There is never a moment when we are actually being truthful to ourselves and to other sentient beings. In the Western world, you have the story of Cry Wolf, the very famous story. Same way, Cry Wolf, and why did the people, the villagers, refuse to believe this young boy? Is because he would always lie and say there was a wolf that wasn't there. In the same way, sentient beings no longer can rely upon those meditators who have the appearance of meditation, and we sit in meditation constantly saying, I meditate for the benefit of sentient beings. But if the hollowness itself is filled with nothing but my own happiness, my own suffering, my own sort of fulfillment of my own wishes, then such a person verbally says for the benefit of all sentient beings, but does not actually implement that into the practice. Therefore, such meditations cannot be called meditation at all. So therefore, here Nagarjuna says, in order to eliminate such faults from one's meditation, it is very essential that one's mind stream in meditation be filled with genuine, pure thoughts. No matter what practice you do, whether you have a formal practice or not, but the four immeasurables are the filling, the dharanis of that the meditator sitting in the meditation posture. At all times, in the beginning, in the middle, and in the end of your meditation, mind must always be filled with the first immeasurable quality of loving kindness. As many of the teachers, especially Jigme Lingpa's very detailed commentary on the four immeasurables, he says, fill it with the mind stream similar to that of a mother whose only child sleeps soundly in front of herself. And so if a mother really wishes for a child, and then after years of working towards it, finally has a beautiful baby, and that beautiful baby, after being born, sleeps on her lap and is soundly asleep, her mind is filled with immense care and love for this own child. And at that moment, she has nothing in her mind but genuine love for the child. There is no particular designed way of how that love is expressed. It is nothing but a warm feeling in her mind. Such should be the mind stream of the meditator for all sentient beings. And that is then what is called genuine maitri, genuine friendliness, genuine loving kindness for all sentient beings. Now, if this child would then suffer from some ailment and is very critically ill, the same mind of the mother is filled with pain for her own child and willing to do anything that is within her own reach and possibility that can and has the possibility of lessening the pain and suffering and the sort of obstacle to the life of the child. And there's tremendous sympathy, tremendous concern, tremendous love for the child at that moment. Similarly, that kind of wish to alleviate the suffering of all sentient beings must also be filled in the mind stream of the meditators, which is then called karuna in Sanskrit or compassion in English, genuine nyingje, as we say. And so the Tibetan word itself, the nyingje word, is sense of one's heart bleeding for the others, sort of tenderness of one's own heart, that feeling that is then felt for other sentient beings. In your own mind, that should be developed. And many of you who have now received teachings for many, many years must always add something else to it is, why is it still so less in feeling the same way, with that same kind of intensity towards all sentient beings? How many more teachings will it take before one's own mind can be filled with such undiluted pure love, pure kindness, pure compassion for sentient beings? And then, similarly, as you work with the Maitri and the Karuna, with the loving kindness and compassion, likewise then, developing also in your meditation at all times, I am a meditator simply has to also personify this third immeasurable quality of joyfulness. One must be a happy meditator, genuinely joyful meditator. The opportunity that you have, the capability that you have, the knowledge that you have, the know-hows that you have, the skillful methods that you have, the teachings that you have, the lineage support, the teacher's support, the blessings of the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and your own precious human existence, your diligence, your devotion, your wisdom, your abilities, all of these qualities, if you were to reflect upon, there is no person more fortunate than you are. That is enough reason to be extraordinarily happy to have found such a situation in your life that nobody else in the world, millions and billions, if you look in all the 10 directions, will you ever find people like yourselves? And therefore, of course, all those, so when you look around, there may be some things that are challenging in your life. You know, your husband may be challenging, wife may be challenging, children may be challenging, work may be challenging, no work may be challenging. You know, money is always a challenge among the Buddhist community members. Time is always a challenge. That's all fine, but you can count them on your fingers, isn't it? But if you look at and count the number of good, fortunate circumstances, you cannot count them on your fingers at all. It's a long list of things. And therefore, being able to really have a sense of genuine happiness at the opportunity that you have, that you are one of those very rare and few people who not only have control over your life, but you have the freedom to exercise that control. And extraordinarily, more to that is that freedom and control that you have over your own life enables you to also be free in helping others. And not many sentient beings, even the wealthiest of the wealthy, may not have that opportunity. People who have large families and are never alone may never have that opportunity. People who have the best of the jobs yet may never have that opportunity. People who have sort of solitude and possibilities may also not have that opportunity. People who may have every good situation happening in their life still may not have that ability. Some who are in caves may not have this ability. Some who are in great powerful positions yet may not have that opportunity. In your own country, you have the wealthiest of the wealthy. You have the poorest of the poor. You have the busiest of the busy. You have the sort of non-busiest person of the world also living here. People who are out on the streets here in Berkeley, you see them many lying there, absolutely nothing to do, homeless or whatever it is. 10 o'clock in the morning, the whole world is running around. They're all sleeping over there, seemingly have a lot of time, isn't it? But they don't have the same opportunity as you do. Therefore, it's not the time, it's not the wealth, it's not the people or the absence of people, it's not the relationship or the non-relationship. It's not these reasons that bring about the obstacles in your life. Beyond all of these things which are and which shouldn't be there, if one could have the best of the opportunities, that's very fine. But you see that everyone has those and yet cannot use them. But you, with or without, supremely have that opportunity to actually have the freedom and the awareness of that freedom and the ability to use that freedom. That is, I think, something to be treasured, something to be thought about, and a cause of great joyfulness. That should be the only reason why you practice. That is more than what you need. That is the best inspiration that you will ever need. Many people say, the distance between the teacher and the lineage, I lack in inspiration because of that. That's never true. If you really look at the fundamental qualities that you yourself are endowed with, that's all the inspiration that we actually need to utilize our precious human existence in the best possible way. And therefore, with that, being very joyful. That's one way to to look at the generation of joyfulness. But very essential is that in every good action that you do, be very happy. Be able to really enjoy, be able to really generate sense of value, sense of worth in being able to accomplish the good actions. In the same respect, immeasurable joyfulness is usually taught in the context of joyfulness at the accomplishment of the others. And so bitterness and the lack of happiness often comes about, especially in spiritual people. It is a very dangerous thing that we begin to develop as a habit, and that is criticism, a very critical eye and a cynical behavior that we begin to develop. Language of religion, spiritual language, psychologically affects human beings to a degree where you are always taught to discern between what to cultivate and what to abandon. Our life in spiritual studies is led in identifying faults and with the hope that we abandon the faults. But when we are very adept at identifying faults, not necessarily abandoning them, but we begin to develop a skill in identifying faults, it builds up a cynical attitude in one's own self. And very often, because of our ego's play, the cynicism and the critical eye that we develop is more directed to the outside world rather than to one's own self. It is bad in both the cases. Being cynical about yourself stems your progress. In the same way, when the cynicism and the critical tendencies are more directed to the outside, jealousy, competitiveness, and subtle aggression develop from these critical ideas. Therefore, it is very essential. The third immeasurable quality is much more kindness towards yourself. Loving kindness is directed to the outside. Compassion is directed to the outside. But this third and the fourth immeasurable, especially the third, is a very skillful way of being kind to yourself, in that it does not allow you to create negative karma of aggression, jealousy, hatred, and competitiveness. And secondly, it allows you to be more at peace within your own self, that the spiritual practice that you do doesn't harm you so much, but it brings about a genuine happiness, which is the only ground upon which love and kindness can actually be generated. The first two immeasurable qualities of loving kindness and compassion often will never happen if the third quality of joyfulness is not there. And so if you are always critical of the others, no matter how hard you try to develop kindness and love, it'll either be very weak or very partial, very, very discriminating, very biased. And in most cases, it is that lack of joyfulness, lack of genuine happiness for the others, and the birth of jealousy and hatred and aggressiveness towards the others, the competitiveness, that will again completely destroy the possibility of generation of genuine loving kindness and compassion. So it's very, very important that one trains, you know, almost in a very conceptual, deliberate way, you have to train yourself to be non-critical of the others. When you look at other people, our teachers used to really let us practice this, and Rinpoche would always say, when you look at the people, count immediately 5 good things that you can think about the person. When you look at any form, think about 3, 5, whichever number you may come up with, good things about the form. When you hear a sound, immediately think a good thing about the sound. Think of a better quality, a good quality, and then watch your mind and see how difficult it is to do that, and how a habit has been formed where we look at something and we find the blemish, where we look at something and we find the fault, where we look at something and begin to immediately criticize. And so the Western psychology, or even the, I don't know, some of the group therapies, when they do, they have this half glass empty or half glass full theory. I remember when I was a young child, I went to a Christian seminary, and we had this opportunity to work with the bishop, and the bishop would held a seminar for the young children. And at that time, he would let us, I remember the very example when he poured a glass of water, half a glass of water, and then he made us say, what do you see? Do you see half full or half empty? And similar to that, I think this is a good example, is how many of us tend to develop in our life a habit of seeing the fault more, what is lacking more than what is good there. Therefore, in the practice of the four immeasurables, being able to really take time to think good of the others, and in seeing their goodness, being happy. Somebody else has had an accomplishment, really being happy for that person. As you know, many people tend to say, oh, very good, very nice. But in their own mind, there is no generation of genuine appreciation and joyfulness. Not in that way. Your joyfulness is, and the expression of happiness at the accomplishment of the others shouldn't stop at saying something good. But watch your mind. It's all about your mind. From the depth of your own mind, you really wish good for the others. That is then said to be generating immeasurable mudit, as in Sanskrit, or immeasurable happiness, joyfulness in the accomplishment of the others. And as our kind Mahayana teachers have taught, if you find nowhere in the human realm someone to really see as fully endowed with good qualities, begin with the Buddha himself. And so at least the Buddha's good qualities is something that is unquestionable. So see the Buddha, and then in your mind see how much good qualities you see in the Buddha and express joyfulness in his goodness. Then in the bodhisattvas, and see the goodness and the qualities and express joyfulness. Then in that way, gradually expanding towards all the other beings and sentient beings, and then good human beings who are able to do so much for the general welfare of the world itself, whether it is His Holiness or whether it is Nelson Mandela or whoever, different kinds of people that you think about, in whose sort of bringing to your mind, your heart and your mind appreciates the qualities. Training your mind to be joyful in the accomplishment of the others is then said to be the antidote to jealousy, to competitiveness, to cynicism and criticism, and subtle aggression that is developed in one's own mind. But although not often mentioned, something that our teachers would say is the generation of joyfulness is one of the most skillful methods of generating confidence in your own path of practice. Because when you appreciate the goodness that is around there, it inspires you to become like that. And so when we say, may I walk the path you have walked upon, when we say, may I follow your example, when I say, may I also become like you, may I follow and emulate your example, these are different ways of training the human mind to not fall into habitual tendencies. Frustration, the inability to see goodness in and around one's own self, and the dominance of habitual, the pull of the habitual tendencies, are so strong that they often do not allow a meditator to break free from the habits. And therefore, seeing the goodness inspires you to do it, to follow that example, to accomplish and to emulate that example, and most importantly, to be able to constantly bring your mind to knowing the progressive path of meditation. And so, that, you know, the influence. Yesterday we talked about not being influenced by bad company. Now, in the same way, when the mind doesn't see the goodness, it often feels, oh, I'm the only one who's supposed to be a loving kindness, compassionate, bodhicitta holding person here. The rest of the world seems to all sort of be doing the worst possible things, and nobody minds. Why should I be the one who's always the one Buddhist? And sometimes, I don't know whether it happens to you, but sometimes one thinks, why did I become a Buddhist in the first place? You know, I could have had a much more easier life than this whole process of training and so on and so forth. The despair and the disappointment and the dejection comes into play, and that's ego's trip. So as to counteract that kind of feeling left out, that kind of loneliness, that kind of not seeing this, it is very important that the mind of the meditator look into the goodness and the appreciation of the goodness. And from that, find value in what you are doing. May I become like the Buddha is a big push and an inspiration to work harder in training your own mind. If my teacher can do it, I can also do it. Makes the path of the Bodhi a much more living possibility, a thing that can really be accomplished. And spiritual belief, especially Buddha Dharma, comes out from being a philosophy to a living, engaged path of practice. Therefore, in that regard also, the third immeasurable quality of joyfulness is considered to be immeasurably valuable. And then, of course, filling the mind of the meditator as it is freed from distraction, with the fourth immeasurable quality of equanimity. Equanimity often simply is explained as beyond bias and partiality, and this should be taken very literally. Buddhists must learn to be compassionate without bias, without partiality. It has to, one has to always, even beginning with a very deliberate reminder that you cannot and you are not allowed to, one cannot say, and I would say very much strongly, you're not allowed to have bias and discrimination and partiality. One must as much as possible generate all the good qualities equally with evenness and free oneself from discrimination of all traces, and that's extremely difficult to do. Furthermore, meditatively, this is then the general explanation of equanimity. Then meditatively, equanimity is also said to be evenness or absolute contentment. You cannot sort of not be biased without finding genuine contentment. And therefore, being fully content in all regards, fully content within yourself, fully content external of one's own self, fully content with the outer's relationship to you, and fully content with your relationship to the external world. Being able to abide in that evenness of contentment, pure contentment, is also then meditatively defined as working with the fourth immeasurable quality. And in all these four immeasurable qualities, four faults are something that one has to always watch out for. If you are practicing loving kindness, and your loving kindness is extended only to those that you love very much, then it is not loving kindness at all. Do not mistake that. For example, people say, I'm practicing loving kindness, Maitri, and I'm going to start with my grandmother, isn't it? Or with my cat, or something like that. And so, if you say so many words to a teacher, no teacher or anyone who is guiding you in meditation will be able to argue that that is not a good thing to do. And therefore, you have to keep in mind how you phrase a question to a teacher many times. Because I personally experienced that a great deal is when you've decided what you're going to do, but you nevertheless ask whether you should do it or not. The common approach is to let you do it, because it comes with two things. You've decided already, that's one thing. And the second thing is, it's at least better than not doing it at all. That much is much better than otherwise not doing it at all. And therefore, out of those reasons, sometimes when people say, because I am working with, let's say, older people or dying people in a hospice or whatever it is, and therefore I'm going to practice Maitri, loving kindness with the people who are dying. Now, it cannot be argued because this is a very beautiful concept. It's very nice. And if you're able to do this very purely, it itself is tremendously beneficial. But on the other hand, the downside of it is, why can't you do it for everyone else, including the people that you are doing? Eventually, because we are talking about perfection of samadhi here, remember, four immeasurables or any topic that is taught from outside the context of samadhi as a Mahayana teaching alone, then it's not necessary to mention this perspective. But since we are talking about concentrative meditation, and within that context we are talking about the four immeasurables, what will have to be mentioned is, you cannot fool yourself in meditation. That's what we mean. When you say, I am meditating, you have to keep in mind, are you manipulating meditation to suit your ego's demands, or are you more concerned about the purity, which is the only that which can be called perfection, paramita of samadhi. If it is the perfection of samadhi, such a mind at this moment cannot afford to begin a path of meditation in a half-hearted way. And so if you say something like, I'm going to practice loving kindness, but I'm going to do it partially, I'm going to do it selectively, or I'm going to do only that much what I'm capable of doing or what suits me to be doing, in one way, it's very being very honest, and that's very good. On the other hand, your honesty has stemmed your potential. And therefore, each individual must examine within one's own self and say, here is a point where it's not about the immeasurable quality. It's not about Buddhism. It's not about meditation. It's not about discipline of meditation. What it is about is me and my mind. Why is my mind still caught up? Why am I reining my mind and its potential in? What stops me from incorporating loving kindness to all others? When I say these people, let's say again, I am going to start being very loving kindness to my dying grandmother, then in that case, how is it or what part of my mind is playing a trick to bringing about bias, to bringing about a dualistic tendency that separates the closeness to this person and distances myself from the other persons? So beyond all the apparentness of the methods that we are applying, you need to learn a lot more about insecurity of one's own mind, the weakness and the fullness of the ego that brings about bias, unnecessary discrimination. You're unnecessarily putting your grandmother or anyone else or a group of people as being different from the others. And so here is the same mind that talks about emptiness and selflessness and, oh yes, all sentient beings need to be liberated. And you learn so much about yourself by saying, if it came to a moment, then I would just talk about liberation of me and my grandmother and nobody else. Yes. Yes, Michelle.
Thank you, Rinpoche, yes. In that case, you're doing the same thing then if you're trying to get yourself to practice loving kindness for something that you know you feel revulsion for, or a person that
yes.
you know, because that's still dualistic, is that
correct?
That
is also very dualistic. Yeah. Yes, some people start with, well, let's see, this is the person I really dislike very much. You know, my ex-husband, or something like that, isn't it? And so I'm going to start by being loving kindness to this, and you feel miserable doing it, but you do it. So it's a good exercise. It's a mental exercise, but it is not Buddhist meditation.
Thank you.
It's good to train in it. You know, it has its immense benefit, and it sort of has its own usefulness. So therefore, one cannot discourage people from doing it. But in doing so, there has to be a part of your wisdom mind that always says, you know, you could do this better. You do it for now, but don't make it into a repetition where you limit your own capacity knowingly.
Thank you. Mm.
And so, no, I think, Michelle, you hold on to it yourself. Mm-hmm. And so in that, as we were saying over here, then likewise with compassion, the second also, if the compassion is directed towards only those that are immediately in and around yourself who are suffering, then again, it may look like compassion, but it is not compassion. And so in the Jigme Lingpa's teachings, he says, some meditators have immense compassion for their cats and dogs and cattle and sheep and goat. And similar kind of compassion is unable to be expressed for human beings. And that I find very common in Buddhists. Some Buddhist Sangha members are known to be those who do not get along with any other Sangha members, but are exceptionally kind to their cats and to their guinea pigs and to their little birds, you know, and so on and so forth. How many Buddhists are there who go through great pains to take shrimps into the river or to save maggots or whatever different kinds of things is? But as soon as they come in human beings, in the community of human beings, then immediately they become very angry and aggressive and unkind and harsh in speech and so on and so forth. And then that's again something to look very carefully into, is that in one way, again, you know, you have to be kind to the cats and the guinea pigs and the maggots and so forth. That's very true. No one can argue with that. But on the other hand, therefore, in one's own mind, you have to at some point think, and therefore, even if it is difficult, and of course it is very difficult for many of you, but at least one thing that you can do is reduce. Reduction is very important. And so reduction here doesn't mean so much, and many people immediately reduce by giving up chairs and tables and clothes and pots and pans and, you know, so and so forth. That is an easier thing to reduce. Reduction of plans, reduction of ideas, reduction of mind, you know, that which speeds into thinking many things are important in your life. At a certain point, the good fortune, circumstances, the merits that you have accumulated in life provides you with a moment which you must learn to seize. And that is when, I think there's a very beautiful title, I think it's Pema's book, When Things Fall Apart. The title itself is very sweet in that, when things really fall apart and you don't have many things, that's a very good opportunity to keep it that way. They've sort of not try to rebuild it all up again, but taking that opportunity. And it doesn't have to really fall apart. There are moments where you don't have something to do. Moments when you are alone and have no relationship. Moments where children grow up. Moments where you separate from your spouses. Moments where you have looked around many years for a good partner, haven't found something. Then instead of concentrating on building it up all over again, take the opportunity. At that moment, simplify your life into all kinds of joyfulness. We're not saying make it bitter and sort of desolate, very sad, dejected, depressed Buddhist. That's not what we're talking about. But in being able to prioritize and see what is important at that moment. And always being able to reflect upon, oh, how much more you can now concentrate on really strengthening the cessation of the causes that lead to suffering. And when the value of cessation is treasured, when cessation itself is really understood properly, walking on the path has more meaning to it. Otherwise, here we have this sort of a conundrum almost, where we are walking on the path, but we're not really looking for a cessation, but we want to overcome ignorance and therefore overcome suffering, but the path is weak, the cessation is sporadically there sometimes or not there. And so it's a very vague understanding, and even if there is an understanding, a very vague confidence in the Four Noble Truths. Therefore, here, confidence is said to be generating confidence or devotion to the Four Noble Truths. In the generation of devotion, real exertion of effort in the realization of the Four Noble Truths, then comes about wisdom, prajna. What is wisdom? It's not knowing something. That is knowledge. And that comes from knowledge and discriminating wisdom. Prajna paramita, the perfect wisdom is just the result. It's just the essence itself. It is the essence of realization of truth as it is. When the truth as it is becomes clearer and clearer in the mind stream of the person, that then would be said devotion that leads to the realization of wisdom of the Four Noble Truths. And so the Four Noble Truths, thinking about it, analyzing, being able to experience as well as contemplate on the Four Noble Truths leads to a certain, oh yes, this is how the Buddha meant. This is truly how it is. And so when your mind begins to click in with the idea, oh, this is how it is, then one can say, oh, this is then the birth of a prajna, a quality of pristine wisdom within my own self. And in order to really gain strength or give strength, again, think about it very carefully, analyze and see whether it really makes true sense or not. And if it does make true sense, then realizing that some amount of certainty, familiarity of the certainty leading to confidence is being generated. And so confidence in the Four Noble Truths is the first quality from where prajna or wisdom is generated. Then not only having the familiarity and the confidence of what the truth of suchness or the truth of as it is of the Four Noble Truths is, but generating the second quality that gives birth to clearer or more pure form of prajna, and that is diligence, the second quality. Diligence and exertion, the second quality that gives birth to prajna, also is said to be diligence in realizing the Four Noble Truths. Not just any diligence, any kind of diligence, but exertion of effort that leads to gaining more certainty, more clear awareness, more understanding and realization of the true meaning of the Four Noble Truths. So this is then the second quality that needs to be developed. then not only should one be exerting effort in generating an awareness of the Four Noble Truths, but to also develop the third quality, and that is constant mindfulness of the Four Noble Truths. In order to really give birth to pristine wisdom, or prajna paramita, perfect wisdom, generating strong mindfulness of the Four Noble Truths, a constant mindfulness, always awareness of the Four Noble Truths is necessary. So as our teachers would say, is that before you make any plans, find it or develop this on the foundation of the awareness of the Four Noble Truths. Before you hope for something, always base your hope on the foundation of the mindfulness of the Four Noble Truths. Before you are trying to abandon something and do something, always find it on the foundation of the Four Noble Truths. And in short, whatever you do, whatever you think, whatever you say, whatever different kinds of actions of the body, speech, and mind that you are able to do, it should always, a meditator must always ensure that it is founded upon the foundation of continuous mindfulness of the Four Noble Truths. And in that continuous mindfulness of the Four Noble Truths, it gives birth to the wisdom of discrimination that is able to see things clearer, see things better, and therefore lesser and lesser discrepancy or the gap between the view and the action arises. Then concentration is the fourth quality. Here too it says, concentrating one-pointedly or taking to meditation again, the awareness of the Four Noble Truths. And so concentration, mindfulness, and single-pointed awareness, a concentration that is not distracted at all, but single-pointedly aware of nothing but the Four Noble Truths. And so whatever you do, whatever you rest upon, being able to reflect upon the Four Noble Truths, oh, this is really truly samsara, and how we create from this ignorance again, suffering, causes of suffering, may I be able to truly bring about through the walking the path of the practice, bring about cessation of suffering. Is this causing suffering? Is this suffering? Is this a cause? Is this ignorance? Is this not ignorance? Is it truly a path of practice that leads to the cessation or not? Being able to single-pointedly research on the Four Noble Truths such that the fifth quality spontaneously arises, and that is truly understanding the Four Noble Truths, a wisdom that perfectly discerns and perfectly understands the Four Noble Truths. And so prajna paramita, that what we often say is the essence or the meaning of realization of the emptiness. That again is no different than the realization of the Four Noble Truths. Whether we say emptiness, realization of emptiness, whether we say realization of the primordial nature, whether we say realization of dhammata or awareness or whatever different names we may give, eventually what it only means in simple words is realization of what the Buddha meant when he taught the Four Noble Truths. And so there's an instance where we say, Buddha, I personally, myself, always felt as a young child that the Buddha almost spoke with some kind of, what I would say is, non-appreciation of the human intelligence, to put it that way. As I thought, he could have taught something more complex. He could have begun with the emptiness, for example. Everything is empty. If someone said, Buddha began his first turning of the wheel of Dharma by stating emptiness of self and phenomena, as a young child, I always thought, my, that would have made such an impact in the world, isn't it? That it would be such a fabulous topic to begin with. He didn't do that. He began very basically, there is suffering. There's a cause of suffering. And as a young child, when we spoke, especially as you all know, I grew up in a Catholic convent, trying to talk to the Catholic nuns, I often felt, you know, it sounded like Buddha was a little bit pessimistic about our level of intelligence and understanding. So it doesn't seem like a very much respectful thing to tell another human being, did you know there was suffering? Because most people say, yes, of course I know there is suffering. There are all kinds of suffering. But on the other hand, here today, as we study Dhamma, as we ourselves try to examine and say how much of the understanding of suffering is there, then we find what the Buddha really meant was actually something very, very profound, much more profound and much more deep than someone saying everything is empty in nature. Whether it is empty in nature or not empty in nature makes no difference if the Four Noble Truths is not understood. If the Four Noble Truths is understood, understanding emptiness and the true nature isn't very difficult at all. Yes. Yes, one moment.
So that makes me wonder, I mean, there are some Buddhists who don't believe in the emptiness of phenomena, right? But they still believe in the Four Noble Truths, so is that right? So that how would their understanding of the Four Noble Truths be different?
Emptiness of self is understood by most people who adhere to the first turning of the wheel of Dharma. And in that way, they do have an understanding of emptiness. Surely they do have. And because of that, they do obtain arahatship, the non-returners. The only thing is that they do attain Buddhahood. Realization is something that they are able to attain. Their realization is not able to extend anything beyond themselves. That is why Mahayana and the emptiness of phenomena is considered to be also very important.
So realizing the emptiness of phenomena is important for the bodhisattva ideal saving.
Yes, okay. Because if you look at how the turning of the wheel of Dharma is explained, you see that the first turning of the wheel of Dharma, where the Buddha taught Four Noble Truths, is in itself completely complete. There's no reason to go anything beyond that. Four Noble Truths, and then to understand the Four Noble Truths, the 12 interdependent originations. And then to challenge whether or not your understanding of the Four Noble Truths and the 12 interdependent origination is accurate, Eightfold Path is the challenge. If you're able to find that the Eightfold Noble, in following and adopting the Eightfold Path, Eightfold Right Path, there is no difficulty at all. You have no problems in being able to have right thought, right speech, right action, right concentration, mindfulness, and livelihood, and so forth. Then it is considered to be is that because of the spontaneity in which way you can then have the practice or be able to engage in the Eightfold Path, you have correctly understood the 12 Nidanas. And the 12 Nidanas is pretty much a further elaboration of the Four Noble Truths. However, in bringing up the challenge, you say, I have a very good understanding of the Four Noble Truths, and I also know how the 12 Nidanas seem to work. But I have problems with not really being able to bring 100% purity in the adopting of the Eightfold Right Path. Then it became necessary for Buddha even to then expound the second wheel of Dharma. Second wheel of Dharma, where he taught emptiness, as we say, is mainly again based on three subjects. And so when he taught about the 18 elements, the six senses, six sense consciousnesses, and the six sense objects, which are the 18 ayatanas, 18 elements. And then further on that way, again, in order to further elaborate on the 12 Nidanas, he then explained the five aggregates, the five skandhas, that is form, feeling, perception, formation, and consciousness. And then the challenge was five paths, or what is called today the 37 practices of the Bodhisattva. And so if you were able to really see and have a sense of being able to adopt all the five paths, accomplish all the five paths, through the practice of the 37 practices, then such a person would be someone who could confidently say, yes, I understand what the Buddha meant and taught in the second turning of the wheel of Dharma, as well, therefore, of the first turning of the wheel of Dharma. So the first turning, Four Noble Truths particularly, is complete in its own self. When we miss that, when we know somewhat what the Buddha meant, and yet we are unable to really bring it to fruition through not being able to fully engage in the Eightfold Path, we have no other reason but to, other option but to go deeper into an elaborate, more complex understanding, and that is where the second turning becomes very useful. And in some cases, the second turning is also, then again, very good. We understand, yes, of course, all of us are there, where we know we are able to see the consciousnesses, how it functions. We're able to see that the skandhas are also leading to emptiness, and through the cultivation of the 37 practices, we begin to see selflessness of self and selflessness of phenomena, and yet it pretty much remains a theoretical understanding, unable to really bring about the full exhaustion, full cessation of ignorance, then we have to no other way but to go on to the third turning of the wheel of Dharma. And so third turning of the wheel of Dharma, where the Buddha nature, teachings on the Buddha nature, luminous nature of the mind is taught, what is Buddha, what is Dharma, what is Sangha, what is qualities, what are activities, what is Buddha nature, these different subject matters are again further elaborated upon, then that only is, and one should be able to see that these are more materials available to better understand second turning, to better understand first turning, to better understand actually the Four Noble Truths. So in our case, again, Buddha nature, we do know Buddha nature is luminous emptiness, but then we're still stuck, isn't it? Then Vajrayana comes into being, and then creation, and then completion, and exhaustion, and so on and so forth. And so ultimately, after 20, 30, 40 years of struggle, you finally say, oh yes, there is suffering. I must get rid of it. And that suffering was most unnecessary. It just was out of this ignorance. And the ignorance has no reason. Why should I sort of foolishly hold on to something that has no form, that has nothing to cling upon, and make it worse by clinging, not only clinging, but worsening it by accumulating millions of karma that becomes the cause of existence? May I sever ignorance. If you understand it from the Four Noble Truths, best.
I'm not asking for more.
Yes.
My question, does evolve suffering, the understanding of suffering? Mm-hmm. I have been told that suffering is a delusion. Mm-hmm. And when I say, is yes. it?
Is it? No, you have to correctly understand it. All sufferings are delusions. What do you understand from that? Suffering is not happening. If you understand this to mean suffering is not there, you're only imagining things. If you understand it in that way, it's not a full correct understanding in that case. When we say suffering is delusion, you have to say, since the mind has created a delusion, it further fuels the suffering.
I see. The second question is the mind the heart? I have been
Is the mind the heart?
Uh-huh. So that it's really I'm not thinking with my brain, but the distractions and everything come through my heart.
traditionally, the answer is mind is not the heart. Mind is beyond heart. But in sort of seeing how the Western word heart is, what I would say is heart is an aspect of mind. Heart is an aspect of mind that has gained more prominence than it should.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
Yes, I think you answered the first part of my question, but the acoustics in the room, I wasn't sure.
Uh-huh.
Were you saying that if one follows Theravada
uh-huh.
fully, completely, that one could also understand completely emptiness of phenomena?
Scholastically, if you argue with this, they would always disagree. And Tibetan Buddhists are always taught to disagree with this, and say that no, it is not complete, and therefore there is the need to really cultivate a sense of awareness or realization of emptiness as a totality, not only emptiness of self, but emptiness of the phenomena too. So that's a very scholastic way of looking at it. So from a scholastic perspective, let me clarify and say, only a Hinayana approach of realization may not sufficiently be absolute cessation of samsara.
You said may not, but I thought you were saying that if...
But that is my... that is how I have been taught by the abbots to say. Okay? Now what I think, after all these years, what I think is, how could you miss a point? That's what I think, is how could you miss a point if your path has been accurate? if we are calling a Hinayanist meditator someone who is missing a point, then I agree with what the scholars say, right? But let's talk about a Hinayanist who doesn't stop there and who is absolutely a true Hinayanist in that the Shravaka hears accurately what the Buddha taught, doesn't assume to become a Buddha himself, but listens and adheres to the teachings completely. I've always thought about it, and I thought, if you really worked at selflessness of self and really adhered to the teachings of the Four Noble Truths and really taught and learned the 12 Nidanas backwards and forwards as the Pratyekas go about doing, for a time period, many could just remain in that moment. But I've always thought, should a person at that moment also have the innate wisdom, as we spoke about this morning, to say, oh, I am actually conceptualizing this a little bit here. I'm conceptualizing my suppression of emptiness. I'm forcing myself to remain in an emptiness that is not really free from my own clinging. Therefore, I need to liberate this also. Could happen very easily. And I remember talking to my teachers. Khandro Rinpoche, once in his teaching, has said, for a person who comes to such a point of understanding, moving from just this realization to a greater realization that leads to absolute exhaustion is as simple as inhaling after an exhalation. And so, it's always, you have to keep in mind, someone who exhales, it's your fault if you're going to stop there, isn't it? Just as easily, reflex action of the exhalation, you take in the inhalation. In the same way, being able to see, oh, I have also suppressed something over here. I have conceptualized an emptiness of self by forcing myself to negate the external phenomena and realizing what that true nature is a little bit of a deliberateness. May I let go of that deliberateness can very easily arise, because it's 99.9% of the work done already. So therefore, I think in the Hinayana and the authentic tradition of Hinayana, there's an absolute potential of being able to find absolute cessation without it have to be categorized as Mahayana or Vajrayana in that regard.
Yeah. I ask that in part because I've spent considerable time with a Theravada teacher.
No, it's a very wrong concept that we have. This is our bad habit of Vajrayanists and Mahayanists in sort of saying we are whatever it is, higher or greater or whatever we call it. That's a very big mistake we make. They're exceptional. I sometimes think, you know, when we say I'm Mahayana, we are failures of Hinayana. And then when we say we are Vajrayana, then we are failed in Hinayana, failed in Mahayana, and now we're trying out the Vajrayana way. After this, there is nothing else to do, isn't it? And so you better make this one work at least.
Well, that was kind of my limited understanding with this great Theravada teacher, because when I would ask him these questions, to my limited understanding, he was presenting Dzogchen view.
Yes, it is. And if you look at the Zen masters, you know, the method and yet the realization of the Zen masters is extraordinarily Dzogchen. You know, you, in the koans or in their writings, if you look carefully, sometimes we think, oh my, this is what, you know, Guru Rinpoche said, or this is what some of our great teachers in their pointing out instruction talk about, and it's the same kind of realization. So categorizing, whenever we say Mahayana, it is a great vehicle. It's an extraordinarily high vehicle because it allows even people like myself with such limited potential to also understand the absolute truth. And Vajrayana is supremely extraordinary because even the bluntest of the blunt mind is supposedly through Vajrayana able to understand what the superior minds of the Hinayana understood simply with the Four Noble Truths.
Thank you for saying that. When I brought that up with other great Dzogchen teachers, they've almost gotten angry at me for not...
I've got that a lot, too. But you know, this is, again, it has to be correctly understood. We cannot praise Hinayana and sort of deprecate Mahayana and Dzogchen or Vajrayana. Neither can we praise Mahayana and Dzogchen and then not praise Hinayana. Because what we would be doing is we would be praising or not praising a technique. Whereas as a technique, all of them are equal in their importance and possibilities. People who handle that technique has to be taken into consideration. There are lots of Hinayanists who get totally stuck, and other than suppression of their emotions, they're not able to do anything else. And that's why Mahayanists at least have the possibility of going a little bit beyond that, and in that, that Mahayana has always been considered a great vehicle, as I said. So it has to be correctly understood. It cannot be one better than the other. Every method has a great possibility, however, dependent upon those who utilize it. There are exceptional beings who have attained arahatship through the Hinayana approach, that which through Dzogchen and Mahamudra teachings we cannot hope to obtain. And then yet in the Hinayana, there are many people who have sort of suppressed rather than liberated. That's the unfortunate part. In Mahayana and Vajrayana, innumerable beings have attained bodhisattvahood and enlightenment and exhaustion. And on the other hand, there are many people who have lived with Dzogchen their entire life, Mahayana with their entire life, and have not done anything better than the most ordinary person who's never met with any Dharma in their whole life.
May I ask part
yes,
two?
Yes, continue.
In the Theravada teachings, they speak about the first wisdom experience entering the stream and certain fetters that are broken at that point. I think some of us, I might be wrong, have had a glimpse, actually experiential glimpse in body, speech, and mind of emptiness. But at least in my case, ignorance continues. You know, there might be a period of time where whatever arises dissolves into awareness, but then one day it becomes more of a memory of the experience rather than moment to moment thought dissolving. What is the nature of the wisdom experience that I won't find myself in 2 minutes or 2 days or 2 weeks caught again? What is the quality of the experience that I'm not drawn back into my own ignorance?
Are you asking me what is it that would allow the permeating of the wisdom to remain more constant?
Or in the Vajrayana or Dzogchen teaching, is there a nature of, I mean, the Theravada lays it out more clearly to me
yes.
about this first and wisdom experience, nirvanic experience, this is what happens, but the work continues. I haven't seen as clearly in the Dzogchen. It's more like get accustomed to it. There's pointing out instruction. Sometimes the implication is if you really got pointing out instruction, that's it.
That's incorrect. I wish it was, but no. What good is a pointing out and having got some glimpse if there is no merging within it, and if it doesn't become pervasive?
But what is the nature other than accustoming? Becoming more and more accustomed to returning to that wisdom, what is the difference of the quality of the wisdom experience that there's more personal release than what I've experienced?
There are two things, I think. One is, such as in the Dzogchen tradition, the pointing out is very important. Having gotten a glimpse, it is said, having gotten a glimpse, allowing yourself to then prolong the glimpse, make it frequent and prolong it, and until there is a seamlessness of that experience. This is usually called arousing the guru within one as they are, as they appear, as they are directly encountering. This is the term that is used. And that is being able to, in that moment of having in your own meditation glimpsed a certain, let's say, wisdom mind, or whether it is through a pointing out instruction you get a glimpse, or whether we say from one breath to the next breath you see a gap or you see a certain sense of expanse, whatever experience, brief as it may happen, to become familiar with it, to make it sort of repeated continuity of it. And then the continuity being so that there is a seamlessness and you're able to abide within a seamlessness of that meditative experience. This is then the word that is used is nyam, or meditative experience that is used. Then this then would be is if one is very powerful in one's own potential and is able to generate or arouse within oneself one's own teacher, as we say, your own Buddha mind is aroused. However, in the case of people with lesser potential, then such a glimpse must be, even if it is not often happening, or you're not able to gain any other experience other than that very brief moment, based upon the confidence of that taste of that moment, it strengthens your possibilities of your being able to let go. And so that is dismantling what is not for what is to manifest in its own self. And it's a longer process. But that is again the second method that is applied, where we say simply let go of everything other than that which is the very natural nature. And so in that way, all the elaborate systems of purification, all the elaborate systems of creation and completion leading to Trekcho and Thogel, the six yogas and so forth, are antidotal methods that allows the dismantling of every fabricated creation to fall apart until no layer of fabrication remains other than the pristine nature. So these are two approaches that is taken. Therefore, in many of the Dzogchen teachings, you will find certain lineages which emphasize not doing anything but remaining, and certain teachers who will expect you to go through a rigors of many levels of yogas to get to the point. Primarily, the Nyingma and the Kagyu differ in these two systems. That's why. Is that in the Nyingma, you will find a lot more emphasis to stay, 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 get there, just remain, remain, remain. And the Kagyus will ask you to dismantle, dismantle, dismantle. Dismantle and nothing but the truth will remain. And the Nyingmas tend to say, the dismantling itself is a little bit more conceptual. Therefore, just try to remain, try to remain, try to remain. This is where the Maha Mudra and the Dzogchen differ a little bit. I don't know whether it answers your question.
I think it did. It's just keep working. You know.
Yes, because if your questioning is about a clue, then these are the two traditions. A clue, a quick clue. Then these are the two traditions that I've studied within. So these are the two things I've gotten from my teacher. Myself, I don't know.
What?
Myself, I don't know. My own personal experience, I don't know. From my teachers, I've heard these two methods.
Well, thank you, but I think you have more personal experience than you're admitting.
I have no idea. This whole thing about what is the primordial truth? Yeah, it's your guess is as good as mine. Or yes.
Rinpoche, in these two different processes that you just described here, it's I have less experience than definitely both of you, and probably most people in the room. But it sounds to me like there's a danger of grasping. Is that true?
Everywhere, yeah. Every place, every moment.
Yeah, yeah. Because this instruction of you see a glimpse and build on it, like it would. To me, at least, it would. I mean, I've seen glimpses of things. I'm sure it's probably not this that we're talking about. But these, and I was told once that I'm becoming my own meditation instructor. I don't know if this is true, but that would be nice. But you know, then yeah, you think of this experience you've had that does feel like, you know, this great having a good session, like you mentioned, right? And it becomes really important then to not try to have that again. But then this instruction that you're talking about sounds almost like you're also being told to aspire to that. So, I mean, where's the middle ground, you know?
No, the middle ground is not necessary here because there's no contradiction.
Okay.
Because I think often in a sort of a situation such as this, we go from one topic to the other a little bit too quickly.
Okay.
I said this earlier also, deliberate expectations of meditation, deliberateness in meditation, conceptualization of meditation, in the beginner's level is perfectly all right. You know, even if there is a deliberate projection of an experience and conceptualization of that experience, whether it is delight or non-delight, whatever it may be, is fine. Very often, meditators put on a very unrealistic expectation on their own meditation. So if you and I are here having a conversation about almost not having any sort of grasping or any kind of clinging, we're talking at a level where the meditator is supposedly progressed to a quite a higher sort of ability or ability or potential at that point. Those of them who have through the years progressed to such a point where they are brave enough to say, I'm going to work with the subtlest of the subtle non-clinging, then that makes it possible and it is relevant to such people.
Okay.
Some of us who may be very newer into Buddhism, or those who do not have so many years of Buddhism, maybe, but not much experience and strengthened meditation, for them then to assume that because non-deliberateness and non-clinging is being said, that you are going to apply it to your current meditation, may be being overly optimistic at this point. And so earlier this morning, we talked about three levels of meditation. There is the mundane meditation that has to progress by supported with the meaning revealing meditation until it can then be better refined through the four samadhis. Upon the completion of the fourth samadhi, then we are talking about something as what we just had a conversation about, no subtle trace of any clinging and so on and so forth. And until that is reached, then you have to say, where am I at this moment? That is something for next moment or next day or next year, whenever you're going to go there. At this moment, what I would be nice is to just have a peaceful session of not having too many thoughts. So in this moment, not having too many thoughts or analyzing the thoughts so that I can eliminate the not necessary thoughts, this is what I can do truly and clearly, then practice that, even if it looks deliberate and a lot of clinging is happening, a lot of discriminating is happening, it's perfectly fine. So that's why they are in different levels, mm-hmm. and so since that, there is no contradiction as such.
Thank you.
Yes, Ashley?
I have a question about the Fourth Noble Truth. How does the Eightfold Path lead to cessation and not just...
Eightfold Path is path that leads to cessation.
But how does it lead to cessation and not just being good?
You have to rightly understand. If the Eightfold Path leads to cessation of ignorance, then it is right Eightfold Path. If it is not leading to cessation of ignorance, but building up some layer of concepts, then you have to go into a much more deeper understanding of the emptiness of self and phenomena before it becomes pristine or very pure Eightfold Path. That is why you will find mention of Eightfold Path in the first turning of the wheel of Dhamma, and it is also the last thing that is mentioned in the second turning of the wheel of Dhamma. Among all the 37 practices of the Bodhisattva, Eightfold Path is enumerated as the 29th through 37th practice of a Bodhisattva. And last of the Eightfold Path is perfect equanimity, right equanimity. And that right equanimity is said to be that which is without any grasping, any clinging. The 37th practice of the Bodhisattva, achieved only when you are able to obtain the first Bhumi, at least at that moment. And therefore, at such a moment, the cessation truly arises. In that equanimity, when you rest in the last Eightfold Path, perfect equanimity, there is no clinging, no grasping. No clinging, no grasping, because there is an absolute exhaustion of any misconception, ignorance, or duality. And at that moment, the 12 nidanas are completely exhausted. Ignorance is completely exhausted. And the mind no longer creates the second nidana formations. And therefore, it's completely, all conditioning factor, consciousness, as well as name and form, are completely dismantled. Ignorance is not generated, and that is called sort of dismantling of the 12 nidanas, and therefore it becomes cessation. Do you get it? No? let me put it another way, simple way is, if you are going to do the Eightfold Path, right, you're going to have right thought, right speech, right action, right mindfulness, right concentration, right livelihood, right action, right concentration. All of these different rightful things that you are doing, and doing it if there is deliberateness, isn't it? Such as what we try to do. We try to have right thought, view, speech, action. But how right is it? It's a little bit deliberate. Why is it deliberate? It's because it's still clinging. We're clinging to the idea of right and wrong. We're clinging to the idea of what to accept, what to reject. Therefore, outwardly, it can be given the name of rightful path, but it is not the actual rightful path. Because this is rightful path free from kleshas, but not necessarily free from ignorance.
But how would you use those eight to get to the right one?
To get to the right one, then you have to first work with the 37 practices. You have to go right from the top. To simplify that is, in the mind of the meditator, as you look at what the Buddha's teachings are, and probably with this I can conclude over here also a little bit, is for the generation of the wisdom, for example, Nagarjuna here says, is necessary in adopting these five qualities as the aspects of the wisdom, perfection of the wisdom, but the wisdom that arises through knowing selflessness of self and selflessness of phenomena. Everything is emptiness. What is emptiness? And again, not necessary to elaborate for you all. You've studied this subject so very often times. But again, in a simple way, it's being said, other than mind's own assumptions and fabrications that there is there a reality of anything other than our assuming it to be so? If we take our own expectations and assumptions out of the picture, what is the reality of anything that we are relating to? And therefore, the power of the existence of every phenomena, even our own thoughts and emotions, our mental patterns, are also based upon hope of its existence. We think, and therefore, that thinking, the power of the thinking, makes it real. If you go into seeing, we find everything is just a gathering of many aggregates, many different elements. It's a compositeness. So emptiness of phenomena is easy to understand, knowing that ultimately there is no independent solid entity. Mind also is very easy to find its emptiness, selflessness, because other than our having given it a name, there is no solid structure that can be eventually, ultimately known to be solidly existent. And so emptiness of self and phenomena, when? It's up to you how long it takes for you to really gain the certainty of emptiness of self and phenomena. If with sort of, let's say, higher potential of just teachers saying it, you say, oh yes, it makes sense, therefore I have no longer a clinging to self and phenomena, then that's very fine. Otherwise, 12 nidanas, the 18 elements, the five aggregates, being able to practice them completely, and then engaging, especially in the practices of the Bodhisattva's path. Why is it considered to be is these five paths, or what are considered the 37 practices of Bodhisattva, like the Eightfold Path, are challenges. The best word for these teachings and practices is challenges. Challenge to yourself to see how accurate and deep and precise is your understanding of the view of emptiness of self and phenomena. If you really think, oh yes, where is mind? Mind is empty, mind is empty, mind is empty. Sometimes we come up with this belief that, oh yes, I think I know mind is empty. I think I know phenomena is empty. You know, we Mahayanists look at Hinayanists and say, you know, you don't know the phenomena is empty. I know the phenomena is empty. We sort of show off in that regard. But then when you implement the 37 practices of the Bodhisattva, you find, oh, my theoretical intellectual understanding of emptiness of self and phenomena is actually very weak, in that the next big thing happens, I'm completely scared out of my wits and I cling to them, I grasp to them, I fear, I have insecurity, I have hope. And therefore, in that way, you begin to take the challenges of the bodhisattva path or the Eightfold Path and find how weak or strong your understanding of emptiness of self and phenomena is. When the meditator accepting the challenges through engaging fully into the path of bodhisattvas, and when you really, your actions become nothing but the Eightfold Path, your actions and body, speech, and mind becomes nothing but the 37 practices, and you do it beautifully. You do it fluidly. You do it without any difficulty. You do it without any fabrication or force or conceptualization. Why? It's because it becomes your natural skin, as we say. Natural skin because you know it's emptiness of self and emptiness of phenomena. In your own mind, as you deepen in meditation, the idea and the understanding of emptiness, that strengthened awareness of the emptiness brings about a strong, spontaneous manifestation of those that are nothing but loving kindness, compassion, mindfulness, is the five powers, the five forces, or the five, seven limbs of enlightenment, Eightfold Path, all these 37 practices becomes just a natural thing. At that moment, it doesn't matter whether there's 37 or 57, or whether they're just seven in number or 16 in number. That they are, like every pore of your skin exudes with nothing but a bodhisattva attitude and conduct, is where inwardly, not only in theory, but that inward realization externally manifests as emptiness, realization of emptiness of self and phenomena, that is then called fullness of the realization of bodhicitta. True selflessness, true bodhicitta, true compassion, bodhisattvahood. And in that moment, when that realization arises, there is no Eightfold Path to practice. Your view becomes nothing but the view of the truth. Therefore, your body's action becomes nothing but selfless. Your speech has no more any clinging or no grasping at all. Your thoughts become nothing but genuine kind thoughts. Your livelihood or whatever you do, nothing becomes nothing but a bodhisattva manifestation. Your mindfulness becomes nothing but the mindfulness of the absolute truth. Your concentration becomes nothing but the concentration of the natural nature of suchness. And the action becomes nothing but the permeating action of a bodhisattva. That is where it is counted as eight, but it's actually one, non-clinging to self at all. Then that is called actualization of the Eightfold Path.
So until then, Eightfold Path might be more like an obstacle course.
No, not necessarily. In other words, you could say is there is a sort of a very conceptual Eightfold Path. You should follow them. In that case, it would be more disciplines on the path of practice. Then as you progress with all the different maturity, levels of maturity of your own understanding, then you thin the layer of conceptual understanding of the Eightfold Path until Eightfold Path becomes unique and indivisible within the realization of absolute truth.
Thank you.
Yes.
Can you speak about selflessness in relation to how we relate to being the target of aggression or jealousy or whatever other forms?
That is then, again, a little different kind of selflessness, I think, if I may say so, because again, just as Michelle's question about non-grasping, there are levels that you have to understand as what you're capable of doing. You may, if one is really developed as a meditator, not have to struggle with selflessness so much. You know, there is never such a thing as, I am going to be selfless. You have to be selfless. That's a little bit different. When one is in a situation where one is faced with anger or aggression or difficulties that are sort of obstacles directed towards yourself, I would say use basic awareness more than emptiness at that moment. And so everything is a delusion, everything is an emptiness. If you're capable of thinking in that way, then that's different. For example, if someone was being very aggressive to one of our teachers, very oftentimes I've seen them not have any problems with it, because their mind is cultivated and developed to such a degree that there is no, you know, sort of pain or fear or any kind of difficulty that they experience, so they are able to let go of it very easily. You and I don't have that kind of capacity at the moment. Therefore, being able to be mindful of your own potential and in accordance to the potential that you have, if you react, that would make more sense. So some people, Buddhists, very oftentimes they do that. Oh, I have to really see it as an illusion, or be able to really, that's also the same question is there, is that suffering is illusion, but I'm feeling this suffering, and how am I going to look at it as an illusion? These questions do arise because people do not relate to a situation according to their potential, but they relate to it according to what they aspire to have as a potential. There's a difference. And so keeping things short here, I would say is, if you are sometimes subject to somebody else's aggression, rather than being able to see it as emptiness or selflessness, I would say be patient. That's very important. Be patient and stay away from trouble. Wisdom, compassionate wisdom, is very, very important. Yes? Uh-huh. And then hope. Later on, you can develop such a selflessness that you're in the middle of aggression and not affected by it.
So I've experienced many moments where, especially coming straight from sitting, walking out of Shambhala Center and having someone come right at me,
uh-huh.
yelling and threatening uh-huh. to attack me, where I've handled it.
Uh-huh. Well, recite mantras, be patient. Recite mantras, be patient. Talk, think about a slogan immediately. These are very deliberate methods and not as powerful as immediately being able to dissolve into the natural expanse of Dhammata, but better at that moment. There are three things you can do. Liberate it into the natural expanse of emptiness. See the other as the idam deity in manifestation. Or be patient. And you see, which capacity do I have at this moment? Which works best? No method or technique is better or more advanced than the other. The best is that which comes immediately and is the most easy for you at that moment, that keeps you away from creating negative actions. That's the best method, always.
Okay. So I'm creating them?
Creating negative actions. If you are angry, for example,
reacting.
You try to let go, but nevertheless you're not successful and you get more irritated and you retaliate, for example, then you create a bigger obstacle for yourself. And therefore, in search of something very high or what you think, assume is a very high technique, sometimes that you're not capable of doing, may backfire in creating greater damage to yourself than is necessary at that moment. So patience may not sound as dramatic as letting go, but may work better for you at this moment.
Thank you.
Yes. Here, pass it on. Oh, Michelle keeps it.
Thank you, Rinpoche. My question is about mantra. And I'd like to know at what point
about what?
Mantra.
Mantra.
Mm-hmm. At one point, the meditators are given mantra or recommended for them to use it, and who you get it from. Thank you.
If you've been given, mantras are very, very powerful, very beneficial. One definition of mantra can be called seed of virtue. It is like planting seeds. And so much so that they say, even if you do not understand what you are reciting, but if you recite mantras that are heard, simply the hearing of the sound of the mantra is able to really bring about a planting of the seed of Dhamma in the mind stream of many, many sentient beings. So you have to reflect upon the value of mantras. And then also for one's own self, and the purification of speech is very, very important. I always encourage meditators to carry a mala with them and do mantras. If you really must use your tongue so much, then I would always say use it for mantras. Keeps you away from a lot of problems always. And so I think it's very important. But of course, certain mantras are for certain reasons. And many teachers, probably you're asking that question, is many teachers give you mantras. In the context of also receiving initiations and blessings, they say something like if you're not able to keep the samaya, at least do the mantras or something like that. Then one should do the mantras, but be mindful of what it is that you are accumulating. Say, Thara mantra or Chenrezig mantra or Vajraguru mantra, that those that are more commonly practiced by people can be done without very elaborate visualizations or very elaborate. A meditator continues to exert the effort of awareness and realizes, oh, subtle clinging to the joy and the bliss is also there. Therefore, this also has to be let go of. Then the meditation on the second samadhi develops further a quality called mindfulness, just a genuine. This mindfulness is very different from ordinary mindfulness. It's a pervasive clarity of a mind that does not become distracted by even the subtle experiences of joy in meditation, joy and bliss in meditation. Therefore, the second samadhi develops into what is called third samadhi, where there is nothing but immense blissful evenness or immense mindfulness or evenness, awareness of one-pointed concentration, imbued, completely imbued or immersed within absolute bliss. And so it's again very high level of samadhi, and there's absolute non-distraction. But within the non-distraction, vigilant awareness of this mind, of this one-pointed concentration, the problem that it has is the subtle trace of bliss in meditation. And therefore, the subtle trace of bliss does not allow it to really become perfect samadhi. Now, as a meditator progresses in this level, then one finds, oh yes, there is a subtle clinging to the blissness of the meditation that I have to let go of. Then that produces a perfecter, a much more perfect state of meditation called the fourth samadhi, where even subtle traces of the bliss is completely exhausted and nothing but purity of the expanse arises. Resting in that is then said to be where a meditator is able to achieve fourth samadhi, also called perfect equanimity, and also called perfect samadhi here at this moment. And this is the same thing that as the Madhyamikas work with this, Mahayana and Madhyamika teaches this, Mahamudra calls it Mahamudra mind or all ground consciousness, and in the Dzogchen tradition, Rigpa or primordial nature, these different terms that are all there are all synonyms of this state that is completely free from subtle and all gross conceptual ideas. And therefore, when we practice shamatha, one has to keep in mind the process of sort of shedding all the different kinds of gross, and then furthermore, even the subtlest of the subtle traces of grasping. Only then can the true prajnaparamita, or the true perfect primordial wisdom mind, can be realized by the meditator. In order that such perfection of meditation comes about, then again, following all the other paramitas, being able to really work with all the other teachings becomes necessary. And so understanding one's journey in meditation carefully and seeing from this perspective how diluted our meditation is. You know, when we sit on the thing and we're looking at this or we're looking at that, and thoughts are good and thoughts are not good, this is then very much should be seen by meditators as, you know, kindergarten. You know, when small children in the kindergarten school fight over Play-Dohs, isn't it? I have more pink and you have more blue Play-Dohs, and they're very serious about who has bigger amount of Play-Dohs and so on, and who's the favorite of the teacher and who's the lazy one. And, you know, children point at one another and say, teacher, teacher, he did this something bad or something good. Then when we do our shamatha, the sort of normal shamatha, my thoughts, my feelings, my teacher, this is to abandon, this is to cultivate, should all be seen as a group of kindergarten children trying to bring about perfection of samadhi. And so being able to realize this, the most essential thing is not to get into the mistaken understanding of what shamatha means, but to be able to begin by first very clearly taking to heart Nagarjuna's teachings of eliminating distraction, filling it with the four immeasurables, working with the perfection, undiluted perfection of the three immeasurable qualities that then give spontaneously or naturally the birth to equanimity. Resting in that equanimity, and then every formal shamatha practice that you do, being taken for the sole purpose of perfecting equanimity. Whether or not your equanimity is perfect or not, always gauged by the traces of the four samadhis and the progressive stages of the four samadhis. That's the way then the fifth paramita, paramita of samadhi, is practiced. Okay, so I'll stop here, and then the wisdom part we can do in the afternoon session.